Today we're taking a look at the Latte Panda MU, an ultra-compact x86 compute module with an Intel N100 CPU. We'll take a look at the hardware and accessories, then we'll get Windows running on it and see how it handles video playback, then run some benchmarks including Geekbench and 3DMark, and we'll also test its power consumption. I've got the Latte Panda MU starter kit that includes the MU compute module, an active cooler, a battery and some screws for the cover plates, the light carrier board, and two acrylic base plates. First up, let's unbox and take a look at the MU compute module itself. The bare module is tiny. It measures just 60mm wide and 70mm long, although you'll need to use a carrier board with it, so in practice the system will be a bit bigger. The MU is available in two CPU options and two RAM configurations. This is the N100 processor version with 8GB of LPDDR5 RAM. Then there's a 16GB version with the same processor, and the highest spec version has an i3 N305 processor and also 16GB of RAM. All three variants have 64GB of eMMC storage. This version has a 4-core N100 processor, running up to 3.4GHz. It has a 6W TDP and integrated Intel UHD graphics, running at 750MHz. It's got 8GB of LPDDR5 RAM, running at 4800 megatransfers per second. The RAM is soldered onto the module, so it can't be upgraded. On the back of the module, it has 64GB of onboard eMMC storage. This is also soldered onto the module, so it also can't be upgraded. The MU can drive up to three displays simultaneously, either all three being HDMI 2.0, or two HDMI 2.0 and one DisplayPort 1.4. The intention behind the MU is that it's a module that can be plugged into a variety of carrier boards that can make use of the 9 available PCI Express 3.0 lanes and other I/O to meet your specific requirements. Latte Panda provide a lot of design documentation for the MU and also offer design services to help out with this. For testing, I'm going to be using the MU with the light carrier board, which was included in the starter kit. This carrier board exposes the essential interfaces for basic testing, but it doesn't make use of all of the MU's capabilities. The MU plugs into the carrier board through this 260-pin SODIMM edge connector. Alongside it are two M.2 M-key slots to add a 2230 size NVMe SSD or other M.2 expansion cards like a Wi-Fi adapter. Above those are some Gravity 4-pin UART and I2C interfaces. Notably, there aren't any traditional GPIO pins like on the Latte Panda Delta with this carrier board, but these are made available in the full function board. On the left is a PCIe 3.0x4 slot, which is going to be really useful for expansion. Then we have a range of ports along the bottom. We have two USB 3.2 ports, a Gigabit Ethernet port, two USB 2.0 ports, an HDMI 2.0 port, a DC barrel jack input that can accept 12 to 20 volts, and a USB Type-C power input, allowing 45 watts power delivery up to 15 volts and 3 amps. This is only a power supply port, not a multi-purpose Type-C port. The DC barrel jack input is a nice addition, as its range allows for the direct connection of a 4-cell lithium battery pack, without requiring additional voltage regulation. This is really useful for mobile devices and projects. Although it does support power delivery input through the USB Type-C port, it is a little disappointing that this doesn't support the PCIe port. You can only use that with the DC input. Also, although the DC input is stated as being able to accept 12 to 20 volts, it looks like you have to use a 12-volt adapter if you plan on using the PCIe port, so power is likely routed straight to the port. This is not all that clear on the product pages or on the carrier board itself. It just says that the PCIe port is only available if you use a 12-volt DC power supply, not that you can't use a higher voltage. I don't really want to test what happens if I plug a PCIe card in with a 15-volt supply, but I expect I already know the answer to this. To provide cooling to the MU, the kit includes their standard active cooler with a fan on it, which has a heat dissipation capacity of 35 watts. If you don't need sustained power from the MU and prefer a passive cooling solution, they also have two passive heatsink options, one with a 10-watt capacity and one with a 15-watt capacity. In terms of cost, the Latte Panda MU module costs $139 for the base N100 8GB model, and it goes up to $259 for the N305 16GB flagship. This makes it quite a lot more expensive than something like the Radser X4 that I showed recently, and especially considering that the X4 has all of the ports ready to go, while you'd need to add a $39 carrier board to the cost of the Mu to be able to use it. So you'll need to be making use of the Mu's available additional I/O and interfacing features to justify the cost. The Mu comes preloaded with Windows 11. Being x86, the Mu does have some advantages over ARM-based SBCs like the Raspberry Pi or Rockchip-based boards. The Mu runs full Windows 10 or 11 natively, without any workarounds like emulation or ARM builds. It also runs standard full desktop x86 applications, so you've got a lot more flexibility. Even if Windows isn't for you, x86 supports a wide range of Linux distributions. The downsides are that x86 systems typically have a higher power consumption than similar ARM-based systems, which means they're often less useful for ultra-low power applications, like running from a battery. But we'll take a look at power consumption in a bit. If we open up Task Manager, we've got our Intel N100 CPU with 4 cores and a base speed of 800 MHz. We've got 8 gigs of RAM running at 4800 megatransfers per second, our 64 gigs of eMMC storage, and integrated Intel UHD graphics. Video playback on YouTube at 1080p is flawless, both in the window and in full screen. Stepping it up to 4K, the Mu also handles playback effortlessly, without any issues both in the window and in full screen. So the Mu would be a great device for a home media server. Running 3DMark Nightraid, which is tailored towards integrated GPUs, we get a score of 4,663, and an average score over 3 tests of 4,656. This is made up of a graphics score of 4,905 and a CPU score of 3,646. This isn't bad for an integrated GPU on a low power chip, and also a CPU that's just made up of 4 efficiency cores. Running Geekbench, we get a single core score of 1,116 and a multi-core score of 2,976. The averages over 3 tests were 1,121 and 2,980 respectively. Running a storage speed test, the EMC storage is quite slow. Writes start off at 240 MB per second, but consistently drop to around 140 MB per second when writing a 1 GB file. Reads are around 260 to 280 MB per second. This is okay for the operating system, but you'd benefit from rather booting from an attached NVMe drive. Fan noise depends a lot on what you got running and what your power settings are. With the low load on the CPU, the fan is barely audible. It runs at under 34 decibels. Under full load, the fan spins up and is then quite noisy, getting up to about 46 decibels. If you aren't putting a heavy load on the Mu for long periods of time, then one of the passive coolers is probably a better desktop option. Power consumption is really good for an SPC running an Intel CPU. It uses a little under 6 watts when idle on the desktop, and when maxed out on all CPU and GPU cores, we get a little under 22 watts. Interestingly, it still uses about a quarter of a watt when shut down completely. Thermally, the active cooler does really well, keeping the CPU under 55 degrees at full load, and the surface of the cooler is about 8 degrees warmer than ambient. I did also try plugging in an NVMe adapter into the PCIe port to try it out. Through that, I was able to add a 2280 size 2TB Crucial P3 Plus drive to the Mu. This drive gets significantly faster read and write speeds than the onboard eMMC storage, getting around 780 MB per second. You can also use this port to add faster networking adapters or even a GPU. So overall, the Mu performs well and has a good set of features. It's power efficient and really compact for its capabilities. The included cooler is great if you're not using the board under full load, somewhere where the fan noise would be an issue. If it is, then the large passive cooler would probably be a better option. I do think it is quite expensive if you're just going to be using it in a light carrier board, as you can get similar functionality from an N100 mini PC or an SPC like the Radser X4. But it might be worth it for you if you're making use of the PCIe port, its ability to run off a 4-cell battery, or if you have a specific use case that can take advantage of its edge connector and a custom carrier board. Let me know what you think of the MU in the comments section below. Thanks for watching. Please remember to like this video if you enjoyed it, and subscribe for more tech and electronics projects, tutorials, and reviews.